Good evening, and welcome to Grace Episcopal Church for our Christmas Eve service. Please let us take a moment first to silence our cell phones and turn off electronic devices before we begin. And let us stand as we are able for our opening song, O Come, O Ye Faithful.
Christmas candles. We know that God's love love shines in our world and in our hearts. We are children of light, and we may spread God's light to everyone we meet. Thank you, God, for being our light in the darkness. Help us walk in your light all of our days.
The yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. you have broken as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the tramping warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace. For the throne of David and his kingdom, he will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
The response is Psalm 96. So we'll say it responsibly, breaking up the asterisk. Sing to the Lord a new song.
Sing to the Lord, all the earth.
Sing to the Lord and bless his name.
Proclaim good news and salvation to the day of the dead.
Declare his glory among the nations.
And his honors among all peoples.
For great is the Lord and greatly to be praised.
His glory to be feared among gods.
As for all the gods of the nations, they are but idols.
Praise the Lord who made the heavens.
Oh, the majesty and magnificence of his presence.
Oh, the power and splendor of his sanctuary.
Ascribe to the Lord, you families of the peoples.
Ascribe to the Lord honor and power.
Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name.
Bring offerings and come to his courts.
Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness.
Let the whole earth tremble before him.
Tell it out among the nations. The Lord is King. He has made the world so firm that it cannot be moved. He will judge the peoples with equity. Let the heavens rejoice, and let the earth be glad. Let the sea thunder, and all that is in it.
Let the field be joyful, and all that is therein.
Then shall all the trees of the wood shout for joy before the Lord when he comes.
When he comes to judge the earth,
he will judge the world with righteousness,
and the peoples with his truth.
The second reading is from Titus. For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all, training us to renounce impiety and worldly passions, and in the present age to live lives that are self-controlled, upright, and godly, while we wait for the blessed hope and the manifestation of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. He it is who gave himself for us that he might redeem us for all inequity, and purify for himself a people of his own who are zealous for good deeds. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God. Let us stand together as we are able for the Gospel song on page 6 in the large print bulletin and on page 7, Sleep. We will sing it twice before the Gospel reading and once after.
Gently sleep in the arms of Lord, receive your prayers.
In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration. It was taken off while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and the family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged, and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. She gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in bands of cloth, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all people. For to you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth, and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those who be favors." When the angels had left the shepherds and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go down to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has given unto us." They went with haste and found Mary and Joseph, and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Child is the fulfillment of the promise made by God and spoken through the prophets centuries ago. This is the night, my friends, that we have been waiting for all Advent season. For tonight, we celebrate what is known in the church as the Feast of the Incarnation, what we have come to call Christmas. This is the celebration of the time when our God took on human form. Now, incarnation is the union of a divine being with a mortal to conceive and bear a child who is half God and half human. Greek and Egyptian mythology is full of such creatures, but our Christian faith assures us that Jesus is the only Son of God, fully human and fully divine. Now we might imagine that God taking on flesh would look something like an invincible superhero, someone with great earthly power and strength. That's probably what the Hebrew people imagined as well when they talked about the coming of Messiah. But God did not come as a supernatural warrior king. Instead, he came as a baby, starting off life exactly the same way that the rest of us do, as a small, fragile, completely dependent child on another person for our very survival. So what kind of God is this? He can't even take care of himself, let alone the rest of the world. Why would anyone believe that a newborn infant was the mighty savior of the world who was waited for so long? This, I think, is the great scandal of the incarnation, the infleshment of God, how God chose to be Emmanuel, that is, God with us. Likewise, God did not announce the birth of Jesus to the city officials or to the religious leaders of the day. Messengers did not go to the busy city markets and gathering places where throngs of people would have heard the news. Rather, the heralds were sent to the unseen people outside the city, the shepherds, to inform them of the new baby. But why shepherds, you might ask? Well, if we remember that Abraham, Moses, and David were all shepherds, and so those shepherds had something in common with Israel's biblical figures, and their presence at the birth highlights Jesus' connection to those pivotal figures of history. Shepherds were also viewed as unimportant and not part of the dominant culture. They were not part of the in crowd. They didn't have social status or connections. They were loners. They were often isolated and forgotten and despised by the rest of the population. But God knew who they were and where they were. And so the angels are dispatched to give them the good news. Now, shepherds could have ignored this divine greeting. They might have thought, why would God come to me? I'm nobody. I'm just out here in the wilderness doing my job, the same thing I do every day, and no one has ever paid attention to me before. In fact, no one has even cared that I existed. So why should God care? Well, once the angels left, in that close, intimate encounter with the divine figure, the shepherds had a choice. They could have gone back to their work and just shrugged off that vision of angels. But instead, they decided to get together and go in haste to find the baby that was described to them. And once they found Jesus, they shared their story with Mary and Joseph and were told that Mary treasured all these things in her heart. The shepherds were probably the first Christian evangelists, sharing their experience of God with Mary, the mother of God, who was greatly impacted by what they said. And I'm sure that the shepherds were also transformed by telling their story. And when they went back to their fields, they were rejoicing and praising God. And even though they returned to their same routines, to their same lives, nothing was different there. But everything was different because God had entered their lives. The shepherds were given a sign of God's presence in the world, a child wrapped and placed in an animal feeding trough rather than a cradle. That may be a bit unusual, but it is hardly earth-shattering and certainly not very glorious. This baby Jesus, bundled in rags and placed in a smelly animal pen, is really a sign of how God chooses to work through the weak, the vulnerable, the outcast, the ordinary people in society who are marginalized and looked down upon, rather than God using the strong and powerful politicians, rulers, kings, or mighty warriors. It may be that the almost magical power of this story lies in the way it humbles us, stripping away all of our pretenses of society, culture, civilizations, and the trappings of wealth, and ease, and comfort. The vision of God in a manger really turns our world upside down. It challenges our earthly expectations of how the creator of the universe should be and should act. And perhaps it appeals to us at some very deep level of our souls because it touches our essential humanity. We find in the simplicity of the birth of Jesus that God meets us at a very different level our being in a way that we could have never imagined or expected. It is easy to be entranced by the spell of Luke's nativity story in this gospel. We enjoy its sublime beauty. We take comfort in the image of mother and child. But its appeal is not only religious, but it promises us that we will be changed and transformed just as those poor shepherds were. The danger of the Christmas story, I think, is that the glad tidings of God's gift to the world can lure us into a false sense of passivity. Because year after year, we hear this story of the Christmas angels, their great glad tidings proclaiming peace and goodwill among all peoples. And yet, we know that our world, our nation, our society continues to become a more violent and conflicted place. God's coming into the world requires action from us, just like it required action of the shepherds. We too have a choice to embrace God's message and proclaim it to others, or we have the choice to ignore it and go about our business, pretending nothing ever happened. Accepting and acting on this good news will transform our lives and the lives of all we touch. So, as we look at our lives on this Christmas Eve, we take away the wrapping paper of nostalgia and sentimentality, the question for us is, where do we fit into this story that we just heard? The shepherds. Do we worry about what's going on all around us? Do we worry about our age, our skill, our physical ability, our station in life? Are we anxious about our careers or retirement or about who we love? Will we have enough money to live? Are we concerned with what people will say about us or think about us? Do we discard the incarnated child because it isn't the God that we expected? Or are we like the shepherds, maybe scared and confused and amazed seeing or experiencing God out in the wilderness, away from everybody, and eager to respond to whatever new thing God is doing for us and has in store for us? The heart of Christmas is the word Emmanuel, which means God with us. The good news of this Christmas story is that God found a way to be among us humans in a way that we could relate to. And just as God found the shepherds in the wilderness, God finds us in our daily lives, right here, right now, in this place, and in your homes when you return to them. God comes to us in various ways. Do we recognize it? So we too have the choice to shrug off and ignore the news of Jesus at Christmas or the things that God is doing in and amongst us. Or we have the opportunity to follow this news and this experience wherever it may lead, just like the shepherds did. Once we do, when we return to our daily lives, we are not the same. My sisters and brothers, my Christmas prayer and hope for all of us is that we may continue to be open to God's message of peace and love, which will transform us. And may we have the courage to listen, to follow it, no matter where it leads, just like the shepherds did on that day so long ago. May God give us that strength and that curiosity to follow and see where it leads. Amen. Now say together the affirmation of our faith found in the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God and true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation,
prayers of the people. Sisters and brothers, rejoicing in the love of God that has taken flesh among us in Christ Jesus, let us confidently bring to the Lord the petitions of our heart this Christmas night, saying,
Lord, have mercy, hear our prayer.
For the believing community throughout the world, especially for those in positions of leadership, that they might always work to give the glory to God and to bring peace to our earth.
Lord, have your mercy, hear our prayer.
For all the people gathered this night to worship and praise God around the world, that we might always bear the good news of Christ, our light in the world.
Lord, have mercy, hear our prayer.
For those lost in the darkness of prejudice, hostility, and fear, for those burdened by the yoke of injustice, terrorism, hunger, and war, and for all our brothers and sisters in any type of need, that the love of Jesus might touch their hearts, bringing them peace, hope, and healing.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
For the homeless, and for the children born in the midst of poverty and pain, that there may be room at the inn for all God's people.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
For the sick and dying among us, and for those who care for them, that the love our Savior may bless and comfort them this night and always.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
For all those who have asked for our prayers, Ina,
Liz, Jennifer, Nina, Frank, Barbara, Donna, Catherine, Karen, Jasmine, Alan, Tom, Sammy, Carol, Frankie, Sue, Leanne, Lori, Tara, Leslie, Elliot, Mel, Connie, Charlotte, Adele, Joan, James, Elizabeth, Teresa, Carol, Ann, Janet, Gary, Sandy, Jean, Elizabeth, Richard, Matthew, Joyce, Donna, Pamela, Rob, Bill, Robbie, Julie, Nene, Brianna, Mary Jo, Scott, Dennis, Sue, Rosemary, Rob, Mary, Linda, Dottie, Matthew, Tom, Wayne, Frank.
Are there others? Bless, comfort, and protect all those for whom we pray.
Lord,
our loving and gracious God, we thank you for gracing us with the gift of your Son this night. Confident of your continuing love for us, we have placed our needs before you. Hear and answer our prayers through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the newborn Christ, whom we welcome and celebrate forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be always with you.
Good evening once again, and Merry Christmas. Yes, you have seen, we are going to share announcements at this time. My name is Amy, I'm the music director here, and if you don't come to our 10 o'clock service tomorrow morning. This will be the last time that we'll see each other this year. So I want to just share a bit of thanksgiving for the end of 2022 and for all of the amazing effort that that members of Grace Church have put into this community. And I want to especially thank, since we have our choir tonight, our music ministry. They've done so much this year. We extended our spring season into the summer so that we could do several amazing special things, including the appearance at the Dion Interfaith Picnic on Belle Isle in the summer. And so I want to just, let's all applaud and give them a thank you for this year. Especially through the 4 weeks of Advent, and so we will be presenting an anthem at the end of communion tonight for you. And when we are done with Christmas, we're going to hit the ground running right after the first of the year to prepare for a Martin Luther King Day celebration on January 16th. I want to put that date in your mind. I know you're thinking about Christmas right now. But the next thing that the choir will be involved in is that particular celebration, and I will be sharing more about that in the next couple of weeks. But we will be joined by the elementary students of Seminole Elementary School to share in a celebration of singing and sharing of the legacy of Dr. King that day on January 16th. That's a Monday. Anything else, Pastor, that you have to share for tonight? Okay, thank you.
Sisters and brothers, walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself as an offering and sacrifice to God.
Our song for the offertory is, Of the Father's Love Begotten, on page 12. The large print bulletin that is on page 13.
Thank you.
And may God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to God.
Let us give thanks to our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Almighty God, we gather around this table like those who thronged your son's manger, longing for you to bring women and men, kings and queens, working people, homeless people, gay, lesbian, queer and straight people, black, white and brown people, all to the place where our humanity and your divinity meet. You had too much love to keep it to yourself, and though we took up arms against you and one another, you disarmed us in coming into our midst as a defenseless baby. As his arms were tied in swaddling clothes, so later his hands were nailed to the cross. Yet you made his birth the foretaste of our redemption, and his death the gateway to resurrected life.
We are your people and the work of your hand.
You give us such joy and peace in your company that our hearts join the angels in the Christmas sky over Bethlehem, singing this hymn of your eternal praise.
Thank you.
let me know. Gary will be standing with the chalice of wine if you would like to dip your host into the wine when you do so, or if you'd like to use the chalice of grape juice, which will be on the table in front of the piano.
Please join in singing our song for communion, Away in a Manger, on page 16.
Thank you.
May the newborn Jesus fill your hearts and your minds with light, love, and peace. And may the blessing of God, our Creator, God, our Emmanuel, and God, our Sanctifier, be with you this day and forever.
Amen.
Going to dim the lights with the singing of Silent Night, and our ushers are going to come by with candles to light those of you standing in close to the center, and just pass the light to other folks around you.
Thank you.
That's news to me.
He's doing the same thing he does at the early service, right?
Mm-hmm. He'll be back in 8 hours.
I'm doing this tomorrow.
Huh?
I'm on this tomorrow.
You're not doing it.
We're going to record it.
Are you
going to
be here?
Yeah.
Oh. Is Dave going to give you a ride home?
Don't know. I can ask.
You should. If he's not going to give you